Penguin Random House Audio presents What Happened to Paula on the Death of an American Girl by Katherine Dykstra. Read for you by Nan McNamara. Note to listeners, this program includes a downloadable PDF that contains the notes and the selected readings from the book. For my children, for the Paulas. If no one is guilty, then everyone's to blame. Susan Taylor Chihok. Preface. Under a washed-out winter sky, I steered a rented car away from downtown Cedar Rapids, Iowa. My travel companion was my mother-in-law, the fiction writer Susan Taylor Chihok. Our destination, a slip of land that spooned the Cedar River. The area was just outside the city proper, but felt otherworldly, barren, desolate, removed. Heading south on Otis Road, the river lazed flat and gray on our right. The Chicago and Northwestern Railroad tracks ran silver on our left. Beyond them, Van Vechten Park's wooded darkness stretched up a steep hill. We passed a giant smoking factory, a cold freight train heavy on its track, and a handful of Canadian geese who'd never made it south for the winter. When Susan indicated, I pulled off onto Miller Lane, a narrow gravel drive that jutted up from Otis, thus far the byway's only interruption. I stepped out of the car into the bitter air and followed Susan through the snow, which came up over my shoes. After intersecting with the railroad tracks, the drive continued under a gate and up through private property, until it dead-ended in a horse farm on the hill. Private drive and no trespassing signs were nailed to trees and staked into the ground before it. We turned right at the tracks, trudging over the ties for about 20 paces until Susan stopped abruptly, turning toward the river. "Here," she said. Across the cedar lay Mount Trashmore, the city's landfill. The puffing stacks of the Cargill cereal plant loomed in the distance. At my feet, I found a rocky crevice that sloped back down toward Otis. And there, sticking out amid a cascade of steel-gray rocks, was the culvert. A culvert is a pipe that diverts rainwater under railroad tracks in order to prevent their flooding. I had gone my whole life and had never encountered the word. But now it was everywhere. That's where Paula Jean Oberbroeckling's body had been found, just beyond the mouth of this culvert. Paula was 18 years old when she disappeared in the summer of 1970. It's been 50 years, and her killing has never been solved. In the summer of 2008, 7 years before I looked down into that culvert, I tagged along with my then-boyfriend and his family to Cedar Rapids, where the goal was to shoot footage for a documentary film about Paula. Susan, my boyfriend's mother, had attended the same high school as Paula. The two never overlapped, missing each other by a year. But in adulthood, Susan had become fixated on Paula's story, filled as it was with conflicting narratives and unreliable narrators, with hearsay and speculation. Paula's was the story of a small city and small city police, of disappointment and squandered potential, of race and class and sex. A story that became more complex the deeper one dug. A story all the more compelling for the fact that it had been mostly forgotten, even though the case still yawned wide open. Susan was haunted by its lack of resolution. The documentary was a family affair. My boyfriend, who at the time had just gotten a foothold in the film world, was the producer. His father, a longtime television showrunner, was the executive producer. And his brother, an art photographer, handled sound. They enlisted a director they'd worked with in the past, and the director brought on a cinematographer. The entire endeavor was spearheaded by Susan. She secured interviews with Paula's family, her mother, her sister, one of her three brothers, with her friends, with a number of the detectives who worked on Paula's case. She scheduled meetings with Paula's boyfriends. She made maps of the routes taken by key players on the night of Paula's disappearance, and lists of relevant landmarks. During the lead-up to the trip, Susan asked if I was interested in helping out with the film. As a journalist, I was equipped to conduct interviews or brainstorm lines of inquiry. But I had no interest in considering the grisly death of a young woman. It frightened me. I was 31 in 2008, and in a stretch of my life I now think of as before, by which I mean before marriage, before children, and before everything that comes tethered to being responsible for the lives of others. Basically, I was in a time of my life that was easy. I was in love, and I had a raft of writing and editing jobs that kept me afloat and afforded me the lease on my small Brooklyn apartment. But even more, I had the extreme privilege of not having to complicate that ease with the sticky web of real life. It wouldn't be until after marriage, children, that my life, specifically my life as a woman, would kaleidoscope, appearing so differently that not only would I agree to involve myself in the story of this young woman's death, but I'd find myself unable not to, convinced as I was that I owed her. That decision would lead me down a long and circuitous path that began with the arrogant certainty that I could solve Paula's death when others had not, and evolved into a different goal. For over the course of the years I spent researching and writing Paula's story, it dawned on me that what I wanted to say about her death was less true crime and more sociological study. Meaning, though a girl had been killed, and though the details of her disappearance and death are important and will be included in the pages of this book, this is not about a murderer. I do not know who killed Paula Oberbroeckling. What I do know is that the onus of her death extends well beyond whoever dumped her body down that hill. This is the story of the grave injustice served one girl and all the factors that conspired to allow, even ensure, that injustice. It is about the reasons it was easier for the authorities in Cedar Rapids to forget what happened to Paula than to face it. It is about the ways in which women are the same and how we are different, and the role society played then and plays now in our choices and in our opportunities, or lack thereof. It's about legacy and the things that are handed down between women over generations. It's about the women in Paula's family and the women in my own. It's about women who lived in Cedar Rapids in the 1960s and women who also lost mothers, sisters, daughters to violence. It is infuriating, but maybe it is also hopeful. My hope is that by giving Paula voice, by interrogating the generally accepted story of her life and death, by searching for nuance, I might pay my debt not only to her for showing me that my womanhood is important and powerful and comes with responsibility, but to the long continuum of women before me and to come. To the women who shaped me, my mother, my grandmother, Susan, my friends and mentors, to women I don't even know, and to the one little girl, one day a woman, who, when I began this quest, had yet to be born. Chapter 1. The Crime. This is what is known. On Friday, July 10th, 1970, at 9 p.m., Paula Oberbroeckling, fresh out of high school, clocked out of her job in the Mrs. Sports section of Yonkers Department Store, a regional chain in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Stepping out of the fluorescent lighting and into Lindale Plaza's open air, Paula found Lonnie Bell waiting for her. He was leaning against his red 1960 Porsche coupe. Dusk was falling. Paula, 18, slender and blonde, was easily as tall as Lonnie. Lonnie had sun-kissed skin and slick blonde hair that fell to his shoulders. He tended toward tight shirts and faded bell-bottom jeans. He was built like a tongue depressor. Lonnie was 21 and had graduated high school a few years before Paula. He was unemployed and lived with his mother and stepfather in a small house on the northeast side of Cedar Rapids. Paula and Lonnie had met a couple of summers before at Henry's Hamburgers, a local drive-in on First Avenue, where high schoolers hung out on hot afternoons or took pit stops while cruising after dark. But they had been dating only since May, after being reintroduced by mutual friends. Their relationship had started while Paula's on-again, off-again boyfriend, Robert Williams, was out of town. Paula and Lonnie had gone out a handful of times as school wound down. When Robert returned, Paula briefly rekindled with him. Around this time, there was an altercation between the two boys. Fists were thrown. But Robert was unable to convince Paula to stay with him. Paula responded to the fight by vowing to Lonnie that she would leave Robert for good. As the summer began, Paula and Lonnie spent most nights together. The two hung out and drank Ripple wine or went to dive bars and bought rounds of Budweiser. Paula drank Schlitz or Bacardi rum and Coke. They smoked Marlboros and occasionally Cools. They cruised Cedar Rapids looking for something to do, somewhere to go, someone with whom to hang out. Waiting with Lonnie outside Lindale Plaza that night was Billy Ben Carroll, a friend of Paula's from high school, who went by Ben. Paula and Ben had known each other since freshman year when they attended Regis Catholic High School together. Both later transferred to Washington High, the public school. That night, the three of them, Ben, Lonnie, and Paula, planned to go to the Nowhere Lounge to listen to live music performed by a local band that Ben liked. The evening had been Paula's idea. In the parking lot, the three briefly discussed logistics. Then Paula folded her long legs into Lonnie's Porsche, and with Ben following in his black over bronze Mustang convertible, the party made its way from Lindale Plaza East to the Nowhere. There, Austin and Garth, a band whose music was in the vein of the Byrds and other folk rock groups of the late 1960s, but who never progressed past gigging small stages like the Nowhere, performed to a dark room of shadowy people. Austin and Garth recorded a record in 1970, but didn't cut it until 2016. It's called Mississippi Woman, My Own. Lonnie and Ben played pool. Paula chatted with some friends from work. They each had a few beers. Around 11:30 p.m., Paula asked Lonnie and Ben to drive her home. The three got into Ben's car, leaving Lonnie's at the Nowhere, and headed into the darkness. Ben told police later that Lonnie had been having problems with his Porsche. He also said that he'd sensed Paula and Lonnie had been fighting. Paula lived on the white, working-class northwest side of Cedar Rapids at 116 10th Street in a $10-a-week boarding house. She'd been there barely a month, having just moved out of an apartment around the corner from Robert's house after officially breaking things off. On 10th Street, she lived with two other girls, one of whom was Debbie Kellogg, the friend who'd agreed to look for an apartment with Paula when she suddenly needed a place to stay. Debbie was short and boxy, with mousy brown hair and wild eyes. She was known mostly for being trouble. Debbie told police that Paula had seemed upset when she got home that night. She said that she, having just gotten off work herself, had found Paula crying in the den while hanging Simon and Garfunkel posters on the wall. Paula had been listening to The Intruders, a soul group, which Debbie said Paula put on when she is sad and wants to think about Robert. Robert had been the reason Paula moved out of her childhood home at 18 in the first place. The two met at Washington High School. Robert, a star on the basketball team, was handsome, outgoing, and gaga for Paula. He was also black, a fact unacceptable to Paula's mother, Carol. Rather than suffer the tension, Paula packed her belongings and left. That night in July, Debbie chatted with Paula for a little while and then headed to bed. Around 1 a.m., Paula woke Debbie and asked if she could borrow her car, a black 1962 Chevy Nova, promising to put gas in it and that she would only be gone a short time. Debbie agreed. Paula left the house wearing a baby blue Empire waist dress, which the police file repeatedly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.